This is actually, I think, a nice segue to the earlier panel where we heard from Joy and others talking about how it's so important to be able to display data in useful ways. So kind of with that in mind, I thought I'd put this question out to people, and it's admittedly an esoteric question, but does anyone out there know what this is other than a map that looks like it's old and dealing with Scotland? Any guesses? And it's okay if you don't know. So this is the first ever bar graph. It was created by William Playfair back in 1786. It was for a book he produced on imports and exports in Scotland and came up with this concept of a bar graph. So, you know, the idea had to start somewhere, right? So here we've got the first bar graph, and actually William Playfair didn't end there. He also was responsible for the pie graph. And as well, he also was responsible for the trend graph, actually, the line graph. So pretty big stuff. And it's interesting that you don't really know his name. I don't mean you. We collectively don't know his name. So, all right. Now this one, I am sure that we have some epidemiologists in the audience. So you see, of course we have an epidemiologist right over there. So anyone, just why don't you shout it out? Whose map is this? All right, good. Okay, so we don't need to talk too much about this one. For those who don't know, this is, yes, Jon Snow's map. It was, as you know, Soho in London, 1854. There was a cholera epidemic. They thought that, you know, bad air was causing all the difficulties. In truth, it was bad water. I might mess things up if I try and zoom in on that, but suffice it to say that there's a pump kind of in the middle of the page on Broad Street, which was the sort of the source of all of the, you know, the difficulties, the cholera in essence. But he created this map to illustrate it, which, you know, in addition to sort of being the father of epidemiology and understanding the linkage of what was causing cholera, the fact that he created this map, which ironically, in this day and age of privacy concerns, probably wouldn't, you know, be allowed to be printed, it really changed how we saw disease, right? So here's my hypothesis, and, you know, I'm going to ask the panelists, who I'll introduce in a moment, to also, you know, a little bit later to see what they think about this. But these were momentous developments, each about 200 years old or so. My sense is that we haven't made much progress, quite honestly, since then, in using data to achieve social impact, raising local awareness of issues, empowering communities, perhaps doing fundraising, changing behaviors, those kinds of activities. And I'll personalize it, actually. I used to, in my former job, I managed a website called kidsdata.org. And on that website, there's a lot of extremely useful data that would and should speak to parents in any community. And we have data, they have data by school district. And so here I'm showing, for example, bullying, a topic that parents care passionately about, I think. Is their kid being bullied? Here's data on bullying for California, Sacramento County, and down to the, you know, Sacramento City Unified District. I had a hard time trying to engage my fellow parents where I live in San Carlos, California, in these data and getting them to care about these data. And just another quick example. Right now, I work on, there we go. I work on at the California Healthcare Foundation on a website called calqualitycare.org, which has lots of very useful data about the quality of hospital care, the quality of nursing homes. And here's some data about you know, one particular hospital and their rates of for mother and baby care, you know, maternity care. Again, it's a shoppable condition. People could check these data out ahead of time, but we know they don't. And so it's really, you know, for me, who's sort of been a funder in the space, I've been fascinated, and here I'm trying to improve the data ecosystem. I've been fascinated, why hasn't there been progress? Why haven't we collectively made progress in trying to use data to achieve social impact? And I don't mean to suggest things have not been done. I just mean to suggest that the best things that were done were 200 years ago. And since then, I don't feel like there have been that many innovations. And so this is what I've come up with. There's many reasons, I'm sure. Is that historically it's taken us so long to find the data, and then equally as long to analyze the data and to visualize the data, that we haven't really had the capacity and the time. We had nothing left in the tank to actually do anything that you would think of as communication, as engagement, as being out there, as doing storytelling, right? And I think these days that's actually is less of an excuse. I mean, here we are, we're celebrating open data, you know, 160 some data sets now live, and that's just here, you know, in the agency, tons of others at the county or city level. Data are more readily available. Also, we have tools these days to help us visualize data and to storytell with data even more. So now that I think we're on the cusp of being able to leverage data in ways that we couldn't, this seems like an opportune time to have this discussion about what does work, you know, in terms of trying to engage with data. And so we're going to hear basically three vantage points on that. And it was sort of deliberate the way we set up this panel. I'll introduce the three panelists, but we basically have a journalist, a data scientist, and a public health communication expert. By the way, if you look in your book, we have two new panelists, but we are in great shape. All the panelists are really, really good. So don't, you know, we had two that had to be subbed in. So first up, we're going to hear from, I'll introduce them all initially, Laura Saponara, who's a communications specialist at the Public Health Institute and is working on a project, Health Data Plus, that I'm involved with as well, that's all about helping counties, county health departments, better tell stories with data. So she's going to share what she's been doing. And then we're going to hear from Michelle Levander. Michelle's right there. She's the editor and founding director for the Center for Health Journalism at USC, at the Annenberg School there. And as a journalist, she's got a really good perspective on this. Journalists have a natural ability, I think, to be able to tell stories. And using data is something that she's actually been thinking a lot about. They have a data journalism fellowship program for reporters at USC. And she's going to be sharing some of the work that they've done, not here in California, but elsewhere. And then finally, we have Eric Liu from Bayes Impact. He's the executive director, the U.S. executive director for Bayes Impact. There is nowadays, you know, sometimes when you think of data scientists, you think of data scientists that are, you know, sort of helping Google do better work with AdWords. And not that there's anything wrong with that. There is now a crop of data scientists who want to do good using data to benefit the social good. And Eric's company, Bayes Impact, is doing just that, based in San Francisco, a really interesting company, and work with internationally, actually, including in France, on these kinds of things. So with that, I think I'll turn it over first to you, Laura. Great.
There's a mic up there. Sure.
Yeah. Do you want me to grab?
Yeah, if you want to stay up, Andy.
Yeah, I can grab.
Okay. If you can find the Health Data Plus page, yep. That one. But yeah, there we go. Okay. Hi, everyone. I'm one of the subs that Andy mentioned. My colleague Amy Max, who's written about in your materials, her grandfather passed away at the age of 103 on Sunday, so she's back east with her family. But I'm very happy to be here with you. So we are a year ago. We began collaborating on a project really engineered by the California Healthcare Foundation to pair data and storytelling together. And I work at an organization called the Public Health Institute, been around for 50 years, we're based in Oakland. A founding premise of our project is that, just to state the utterly obvious, that data is absolutely essential and invaluable to determining health policy. It's also insufficient, right? In the sense that in order for us to collaborate to achieve health goals, and I'm talking about internal goals related to your departments or to the public infrastructure or goals related to health policy, we need people to understand what the data means, and we need them to care about it and to care about the impacts, what the data says about real people. So we began collaborating on this project, Health Data Plus. We have somewhat limited web access here in this room today. If you want to know more about it, you're welcome to visit healthdataplus.org. We are, so it's Public Health Institute collaborating with a for-profit startup that's based in Seattle called Live Stories. Live Stories is a digital platform that allows folks, and in this case, the participants in our project are people at local health departments, to upload their data into this platform. And then for that data, that the platform generates visuals, so charts, maps, graphs of the data. And then basically the way it works is that you can customize those charts and graphs, you can pin them to a dashboard, then you can integrate your data elements into a story. And when we say story, we just mean all of the elements that help contextualize data. Photographs, headlines, quotes, short videos, things like that, that can help us bring home the meaning of the data, make it accessible and interesting, and also in ways that are ethical and authentic, evoke empathy when we need to, in order to get people to pursue, to collaborate with us to pursue a given goal, right? To overcome the problem we have with opioid addiction, right? To maximize our childhood immunization rates, to reduce the amount of money that California taxpayers are spending on medically unnecessary C-sections, right? So, okay. So let's go ahead and I'm going to show you a couple of stories that are part of our project. Here's one created by our colleagues in the county of Sonoma. Did some original research. The health department did some original research about the health status of farm workers, and found out through this survey of 300 farm worker families exactly what's going on in terms of who has access to health care, and also. And a very important issue in the county is housing. So who has access to affordable housing, and what are the ramifications for families that do not? How does that impact their health status? So that's what this story is about. And so there are, they started out, and a more thorough iteration of this particular report is available online, in a 40-page PDF, awesome, right? But they created this as a way to make the data more immediate, more accessible, more interesting for a wider audience to look at. So you can see, like, there are key messages. Here's some data about the percentage of farm workers that are living in overcrowded housing conditions. And one of the main findings here, which of course does have serious implications for public policy, is that even though we call farm workers migrant workers, they're not going anywhere. These are permanent residents of the county. They're part of the community. And so so we need to plan accordingly about how to elevate their health status. Okay, so basically you can see this is what the platform does. It's a graphically interesting depiction of it's contextualizing data with storytelling. Okay, so just quickly, I know I'm going a little bit over.
It's okay.
Okay, so we teamed up with our project, Health Data Plus, entered into this HHS Obesity Data Challenge. How many people have ever heard of that? Okay, maybe somebody invented it here, I don't know. We won, very proud of that. So that was about a year ago, and it was and so I'm going to show you our winning entry. And basically, this is what we're trying to do, is put open data into play with this type of storytelling. So this is called a universal filter, where you can go ahead and select, maybe if you could select, if you can, select California. And then, so you can look at obesity rates by state. So we're going to select California. And then why don't you select San Bernardino, just for fun. And then you can filter down below by county. We'll look at one of the counties. And then automatically what you'll see kind of populated is obesity rates by county, by state, and by nation. So it's easy to take a look and compare.
I think there's like an error message that came up down there.
Oh,
not
dear.
An error message,
oh, oh, okay.
Dialogue boxes.
Okay, well, never fear, because I tweeted a link to this story this morning using the HHS Open Data hashtag. So even if you don't have a Twitter account, that would be a really easy way to find a link to this story. Again, we're having some technological limitations, but we'd love for you to take a look at it. And I'll just tell you briefly what it does is it promotes through links and photographs and kind of like success stories, case stories from different areas of the country, solutions, you know, a game plan for healthy eating and active living, along with data. So it charts a lot of bar graphs and pie charts and these donut graphs that show sort of like a breakdown of obesity rates, for example, by ethnicity as well as by geography, together with a series of solutions. So I hope to, if we have more time as we move along, we can show you some different examples of combining data and storytelling and talk a little bit about what we're learning along the way.
You know, actually, Mike, so if you don't mind getting Michelle's ready. And then, meantime, I'm going to ask you a question, Laura.
Please.
So we had heard from one of the, it's a question about the templates.
Ah.
Okay. So we had heard from one of the epidemiologists in San Diego County, and her quote was this. She said, the hardest thing for a data person to do is to speak English. The second hardest thing for that data person to do is to write English. But we're really good at mimicking. And so I wonder for you know, because we've learned a lot about how you can help data people communicate. And I wonder if you could talk for a minute about the role that we've heard or are embracing now in terms of templates.
Okay. But before I talk about the templates, I just want to say there are so many people like me that want to help data people communicate really effectively. And Michelle is going to show us lots of examples from journalists that are doing that in really incredible ways. But everyone's talking about storytelling, and in the realm of public health is a really ideal kind of forum for doing storytelling well, in part because everyone's interested in health. So it's a very exciting arena. But templates, so because it's difficult, it can be a little bit intimidating to like take, you know, to develop a story from scratch. sorry, I'm so excited to see that moment. What we're doing in our platform, in our project Health Data Plus, is creating what we call templates. And so it's just like when you log on and you let's say you have a Live Stories account, you log on there and you're about to create a story, and it's a super user-friendly platform, so you could most certainly do it all by yourself. But we're trying to like pre-create, to merely put all the bones of that story together so that people in local health departments can simply go in and tailor it a little bit and then use it. And so just for example, we know that everyone that reports on flu surveillance data sort of has to recreate the wheel when they're putting their data together and disseminating it to people in the health community of health professionals in their region. So we created a template where they upload their data into the back end on a weekly basis. It automatically populates in the system, and then they can republish it and share it really easily. So that's what we're doing, and we just held like a really fun kind of user-centered design session, and we're talking about what kind of future templates we might make to draw attention to chronic disease, and also to be able to kind of talk about health equity in a way that is meaningful and impactful.
Great. Michelle, looks like you're ready to go. Thank you, Laura.
So good afternoon. Thank you so much for having me. I've been invited to talk to you a bit about what the potential is for combining storytelling and data. And in the world of journalism, we've really found this to be a potent combination. And I'm going to share a few examples of how some of the people in our program have worked to really bring attention to issues and to inspire action in communities and among policymakers. So just quickly, I'm the founding director of the Center for Health Journalism at USC Annenberg, and we've been around for more than 10 years. and we have a number of programs, but the central program is one that works with professional journalists and partners with them with an intensive week of education and 6 months of mentoring as they usher really ambitious projects on health topics to publication in their local communities with an emphasis on health policy and health disparities. And so what we're really trying to do is help them move the needle and help them make change. And what I would say is the pillars of that effort involve data, storytelling, and in a sort of new twist for journalist engagement to extend the reach of a story and to make sure the right people are reading the stories, the people who the stories are about. And really, data journalism has been around for decades, but it's really been something that's been the focus of professional conferences, somewhat like this one. And it's only more recently making it into journalism schools. And this is from a report, you know, hot off the press, literally yesterday, about what a crucial literacy it is and how it should be part of every journalism curriculum. And we were really honored to have a chance to do a California Data Fellowship last December and to make our mark in this arena thanks to Andy and the support of the California Healthcare Foundation and the California Endowment. And we're going to be seeing some of the projects that result from that in a couple of months. But we can really see how much more journalists can do when they're going well beyond anecdote, you know, with the data. And I think this is a very fruitful time for us to be having this conversation because there's so much cross-pollination going on. We have a lot of data shops that are engaging in storytelling, and we have a lot of journalists that are venturing deeper into data reporting, partly because the tools are easier to use and the possibilities for visualization and storytelling with, you know, those sorts of charts and graphics have really been much easier to share. So I'm going to just talk about two projects that came out of our fellowship and then show a video where you can hear directly from one of our fellows about this idea of the power of combining data and storytelling. So this is Detroit News, and this reporter, Karen Buffard, wrote a story about the principal hazards to children in Detroit, which turn out to be infant mortality and basically getting shot and killed as a teenager. And it turns out she spent a lot of time doing this data analysis and putting together data sets that don't normally live together, that Detroit is the most dangerous major city in America to be a child. And this is something that I've talked about with Andy, this idea of how do you make statistics sing and how do you make people pay attention to them? Well, one way is if you're the best or you're the worst, and unfortunately, Detroit was the worst. And so, the next day after the first part of this series ran, the mayor was announcing that he was going to launch a major initiative, which he did, and now pretty much any pregnant woman in the inner metro area of Detroit can get free prenatal care, and there's an ongoing series of initiatives around this, and in a lot of ways, Karen is still continuing the reporting, too. And, you know, that couldn't have happened without the stories, because really this was a part of it, having the worst, and the other part was telling the stories of families that had been robbed of fathers and children and just the toll it took and the videos. That's what made it powerful. Similarly, Cindy Yukin from the Billings Gazette did a project on Montana's high suicide rate. Now, this is something everybody thought they knew. Montana has double the suicide rate of the rest of the country, but it almost faded into the background, one of those things that everyone said, oh, you know, of course, and then moved on to the next thing, like we don't have enough psychiatrists. So this really forced her to drill down and to analyze the problem. And if you were to ask her what made this story take off and catch on fire, it was, as she said in an essay that you can find on our site, the stories, and that they insisted that no one be anonymous. They recorded every single person. They made videos, and they put those online. And, you know, in the end, the state launched a huge prevention effort. The governor signed legislation that put a whole raft of new programs in place, new training programs. Theater companies sprang up to do plays around this in schools. And I think that none of it would have happened, and Cindy thinks none of it would have happened if it was just the data. Everyone sort of knew the data already. It was combining it with the stories. And I'm going to just really turn this over in a way to Michael LaForgia, who's not here, but who is in this short video. And he's a reporter at the Tampa Bay Times. And he did a project called Failure Factories that looked at a county, a wealthy county in Florida, where they basically resegregated schools and what the impact is. And he talks about how the data and the storytelling, combined.
The USC Center for Health Journalism helps reporters and their newsrooms produce powerful journalism that marries data with storytelling. The center provides mentoring, training, and reporting stipends to help bring untold stories to light. Michael LaForgia and a team at the Tampa Bay Times published a series called Failure Factories starting in fall 2015. It chronicled the pernicious effects of the resegregation of schools in Pinellas County, one of Florida's most affluent areas. The series unleashed a firestorm. Parents called for reforms. U.S. Congressional Representative Kathy Kassler demanded an investigation of the county's use of federal funds. And outgoing U.S. Education Secretary Arne Duncan came to town with his successor, John King, to find out exactly what was going on. The Columbia Journalism Review said the series represented some of the best journalism of 2015. Failure Factories received top national awards from investigative reporters and editors, won the National Press Foundation's Innovation in Journalism Prize, and is a finalist for an investigative reporting award handed out by the Kennedy School at Harvard University. More importantly, Failure Factories created the climate for change that was long overdue. For this journalism project, putting in the hard work to tell the story with both data and community stories made all the difference.
This was the most demanding, but also the most rewarding project that I've ever worked on. This was the most intense data analysis that I've ever done for any type of story. We basically did the kinds of analysis that could have powered four or five major investigative projects and synthesized that analysis into one project. The five schools that we focused on were awash in violence. They had more violent incidents last year than all 17 of the county's high schools combined. We found that teacher turnover was rampant, and that when experienced teachers were leaving these schools, they were more likely to be replaced by rookies or teachers who had troubled pasts. We found that black students were disproportionately targeted for harsh discipline in the school system, for punishments such as out-of-school suspensions. We found that more black kids than ever before were applying to the county's most prestigious schools, but fewer were getting in than had ever gotten in before. At the same time we were doing this analysis, we were also fanning out into the community. From the get-go, we were in churches in the county's black neighborhoods. We were at community centers and tutoring sessions. We reached out to nonprofits. We attended tons of youth sports events. We even hung out at barbershops, all as a way of getting into the community and showing a community that traditionally had been ignored, both by the government and, honestly, by the newspaper, that we were serious about telling the story and that we understood what was at stake. Usually with stories like this, you have the gripping anecdotes, or you have the incontrovertible certitude that months of data analysis can give you, but you almost never see both. We interviewed parents of more than 100 kids in these schools. Both the data and the parents were telling the same story, one of isolation and disenfranchisement and institutional neglect.
So with that, I'll just turn it back over to Andy. Thank you.
So we'll have, if Mike, if you don't mind coming up again, we'll do the, we're going to switch computers out to get Eric's presentation all set. It requires a Mac, or it doesn't require a Mac, it just requires something that's working on a Mac. But while we're waiting, Michelle, if you don't mind picking up one of those microphones, I want to ask you a question about, you talked about the data, you talked about the storytelling. I want to hear what you have to say also about the important role of engagement, and also thinking about that from the perspective, because one of the things as I was watching what you were saying is that as a journalist, even in this day and age, you have a powerful microphone that most people don't have. And how does one translate that kind of engagement of a newspaper, what a newspaper can do, to being a government, being a nonprofit and such? What have you learned about that?
Well, I once, is it working? Can you guys hear me? Yeah. So I once heard somebody describing public health from the standpoint of, say, a local county public health official as being something like speaking always with a megaphone, that it's a one-way conversation. And so I think our challenge as journalists is a similar challenge to that of public health agencies, which is how do you make it a two-way conversation? And furthermore, not just a superficial two-way conversation, but one where you really are learning from what you hear from the people who are answering you and that they have the potential to shape the reporting and that conversation. And so what we've seen happen with some of the more creative reporters that we've worked with, and we're providing them engagement mentoring and engagement grants, is an effort long before the story is published to be reaching out to the community in different ways to gather that input. And so it can be something astonishingly simple, like you could take a Google spreadsheet and insert it behind a question that runs in the newspaper, like, have you experienced domestic violence and would you like to talk about it? That was something a reporter in Del Norte County put out, and in one of the parts of a multi-part series on this issue, and then she got dozens of replies. And those people, she had to go and check out their stories and use the same rigor that you would use for anything else, but those people became, you know, part of the backbone of her story. So that's on the simple end. On the elaborate end, we've had journalists form nonprofits and bring together diverse groups that were not working in a particularly coordinated fashion on an issue, and get a PR firm to volunteer to create a logo and train people to address the issue, and partner with Spanish language media to raise awareness. We've had in Florida, where they haven't expanded Medicaid, we had a reporter help partner with a local community foundation to raise money to basically launch a doctor survey to really chronicle the incredible gaps in service in Medicaid. And that's going to be a way to continue the reporting that she already did. And so that was like a $30,000, you know, survey effort. And then she's going to fairs and meeting with nurse practitioners, and at the food bank getting packets with resources put into kids, you know, lunches that they take home from the food pantry. So, and the one last thing I'll say about that is it's a way to also reach people who don't read your newspaper, who don't listen to your station. How can you reach the populations that are the subject of your story who may not be readers? So it's a very exciting arena, and I think there's tremendous potential for both government and nonprofits to engage in something like that.
I know Laura's chomping at
the bit. I'm chomping at the bit, just very, very briefly, and with a very deep respect for journalism and investigative reporting. I want to make the point that, yes, journalists have a very powerful megaphone, but we also have the power to tell our own stories and to pair data and storytelling in ways that we can circulate to audiences directly, including target audiences that we define, in an amazing forum that we call social media. So while we can pitch stories to journalists, and that's a really exciting prospect, we don't necessarily that we can also invest our brains and our narrative power and the knowledge that many of you have of the data sets that you're so fond of. We can pair those together and kind of tell stories that are newsworthy to people who care about health.
Eric. Great. Hey, everybody. Thanks for having me. Excited to be here. I wanted to show you a data visualization that we made with the San Francisco Fire Department. It was a volunteer project that we put together. And this was mainly in response to something that you may have read in the news, at least in the local news, about ambulance dispatch and some ambulances from the fire department being dispatched over time. And I think the power of using combination of software and data and putting it in a interactive format is that you can get a deeper depth in terms of understanding some of these issues at hand, trying to have something that is interactive that people can engage with. But also, I think with all sort of data visualizations that we put together, a lot of it is about how does it inform people in different ways, either providing them more information, allowing them to engage with it themselves, or providing a unique perspective that maybe a bar chart or a line chart, you know, can't provide in aggregate. So I'll start playing it here, and it's a little fast. What you'll see here is, maybe it's better this way. So here is a day of ambulance dispatch, and we'll make it a little bit slower. So you can see here's the time moving over here, and you can have, you see a variety of different ambulances moving around. So there's different priorities in terms of calls, low and high, high priority meaning it's a more serious incident. You have different ambulance statuses of some of them are available, some of them are not, some of them are dispatching, some of them are driving on scene. So everything is color-coded here, but the key is it's not just an aggregate statistic of 10% of ambulances are over time, right? We want to understand which ambulances are actually over time and what is the story behind it. There's a ton of local context, right? You can imagine supplementing this with other information about what's happening in that geography. And when you see any red numbers over there, there is a essentially like, I think it's a 9 or 10 minute limit, regulatory limit on how long it takes to get from one point to another that ambulances are allowed to. But in this one, you can see that, you know, they can be coming from a completely other side of the city. They could be coming from the dispatch points, could be all around different areas within the city. And so the important part is to understand, you know, which ones you can imagine are avoidable, which ones are not. And then for our own work as data scientists, this also helps create what, you know, we call the training set, right, of incidents that we want to identify and predict that we want to avoid. But some of them, even though they're over time, may not be avoidable given how the dispatch system works today or the geography or whatever local context is there. And one of the other things that we did is annotations. So it's pretty simple. If we click this, then a message box will appear that you can put information into. So let's say if you're at the fire department, one of the cool things is that you'll, when you replay this, you can say, well, hey, you should look at that more because I know something from that context or otherwise, right? And that's another element of engagement for folks. Let's say if we were to put this into the public sphere for them to understand that, like, you know, it's not that all ambulances that, you know, go over time are doing something wrong, right? Actually, a lot of the time, there are instances where it's potentially unavoidable. So this, I think, level of engagement adds a layer of interaction for folks that's beyond just understanding the aggregate statistics, but provides a pretty cool interaction. I think this is also just fun seeing ambulances move around in a screen and a bunch of stuff going on. I think that's cool. But in addition to that, you know, I think it provides pretty specific context on, let's say, every single ambulance moving across the city. So that's what I had to show. And that's pretty much it in terms of the demonstration. So if you have any questions about this, we can talk about it otherwise. But I thought it'd be something cool to show in terms of a, you know, live sort of data visualization.
Great.
Cool.
Oh, those are great. So I want to open it up to questions in a minute, so please be ready with questions. We really have three pros here who know this stuff really well. It's a good opportunity to have some discussion. But I wanted to start off with one question that I have. I think often as data people, we get used to thinking that data are data, and we shouldn't mix that with a story, that we shouldn't mix the heart with the head. You know, the mind and the heart, bring those two together. And as a result, I think sometimes what we do is we have data displays that can be sterile, you know, because we think it's wrong, perhaps, to mix the two. And I want to get some comments and some feedback from the panelists about what they think about showing emotion alongside data. Is that okay to do? Is it more than okay? Is it advisable to do? So we got some mics there, so we'd love to hear your input.
Whether you acknowledge it or not, there's so much about being alive and being wanting to remain alive that is all about how we feel, right? And whether we're able to take care of our bodies is also has a lot to do with how we feel. And whether policymakers decide to take action, to take steps that require extensive resources a lot of the time to protect public health is also a lot about emotion. It's about data, but it's also about what is going to move us to become healthier and to live in communities that are more equitable, right? Where health equity, for example, is a common frame of reference for talking about how we spend public dollars. So I would say neglect the heart at your peril. That would be my take. Yeah.
Any other thoughts on that, or?
Yeah, I mean, this is just really a fundamental aspect of journalism, right? I mean, you need to find your data and find out what the trends are, and then really find people who illustrate it. Or sometimes you'll start with a story and then look for the data that can bring something to life. But data is sterile without people. And if we're trying to, Michael Wilkening asked this question of, why are we doing this and how do we bring things back to the consumer and the ordinary people in the state? Well, that's why we're doing all the crunching. It's easy to forget that when you've been spending all day with a spreadsheet, but you have to bring it home to, I think, both internal audiences, because I know many of you come from departments and sometimes your audience is someone else at your agency, and also, external ones, and I think making people care and maybe making people see the value of the data will maybe get at the issue that Andy raised about how many people are looking at the data about the quality of their hospital, and how do you make them care? I mean, maybe you attach a video showing somebody and how they made a decision about a certain clinic or a certain hospital. So it's just such a truism for journalism. I mean, that's how. Whenever there's a national or international crisis, the money flows in because you can see the plight of people. That photograph, for example, of the boy, who washed ashore among the Syrian refugees. I mean, everybody in this room knows that picture, right? And because that picture is a story, right? And it tugs at our heart.
Yeah. I think we've got some, I just want to open it up to some questions out there. And I'll just say really quickly that I think we've observed through our project with counties, and I hope they don't mind us saying this, that it's hard for them to show the emotion. And I think government agencies, maybe the state, would probably nod in agreement. That's a hard thing for them to do. And one of the things we've learned is that counties, though, are very interested in engaging with their local partners. They present the data and then let the local advocacy organization or community partner add the story part to that data. So anyway, let's take some questions. I think there are a few. Yeah, go on.
To your last question about the value of stories and being static versus active, one of the things that we see, especially when it comes to legislators, that they only want a story. You can walk in with reams of data, pretty pictures, but unless you can tell them something about their, how does this resonate, you end up having Jenny McCarthy talking to you about immunization versus, or the University of Google versus what we know from the data that we have. So how do we translate the sexiness of the information that we have to those individuals who only seem to respond to that kind of visual stimulus to get us to the point where we want as far as having these outcomes?
Well, I have part of an answer, and then I'll turn it over to you too. We've been looking into and doing some trainings about the neuroscience behind storytelling, and one of the things that has come about through research is this understanding that that stories stimulate one's brain in ways that are very different from the way our brains are stimulated when we're on data. So your brain on stories looks a lot different than your brain on data. And the reason this is interesting and important, one more thing on that end is that empathy, right? When we think about just a powerful film that you've seen or something, when you're transported, when you identify with a character and you are transported into their life or their set of circumstances, and they're facing an obstacle and they overcome that obstacle and you are right there with them, right? This is just a typical plot structure. That experience of being transported and empathizing with that person's, walking in that person's shoes, actually has an effect on your brain. Your brain makes oxytocin in ways that it would not if you were looking at a bar chart. However, we can actually, according to these neuroscientists, increase the retention of data by telling stories along with the data. So then I know that, that's actually kind of profound, but I'm telling you, your data is going to mean more if you're able to contextualize it with stories. And so that would be, that's a beautiful question, and that would be my answer, that we have to do both together, and so then the challenge becomes, and this is also something that journalists have a lot to say about, what story should one tell from one's data, right? So look at the data, embrace the data, and figure out what's there, and then help policymakers to understand that, but also giving them the narrative that they need that they'll remember.
Any other thoughts on that, Eric?
One thing I'd add is that part of using data is seeking truth, and there's sometimes a conflict between telling a great story and telling the truth, and not always, but I think a lot of it is important because if you can find a great story once you're very rigorous about your truth, you have an incredible story to tell. And I think that is something that jumping ahead to the story without doing a rigorous analysis is something to be cautious of.
Yep.
So that was my question, and that is, you know, you lead with the data because the concern is the data wonk that, you know, a story is very powerful and can actually trump anything you present. And, you know, I thought of the child, you know, that you mentioned, but also, you know, remember the bird with the ring, you know, the plastic ring around its neck, and we're, you know, I don't know how many millions of people cut up their, you know, soda can plastic. And is that really what we want to emphasize in with trash? You know, I mean, it probably could have used a different picture and a different narrative to do something a little bit more important than that. And so I guess my concern is, you know, you mentioned it and alluded to it, and that is you have to be very careful when you use story because it could be very powerful and it could overtake the message you want. So we have something called the SACO, the single overriding communication objective, and maybe that's where you go with a story to reemphasize what you really want to get across. Because if your narrative and your data don't match up exactly, then you may be doing a disservice instead of a service.
I think you put that beautifully. And so, but wait, before you hand the microphone back, the single overriding communications objective, can you tell everyone where to find out a little bit more about that?
I don't know.
I thought maybe.
If you look up SACO, S-O-C-O,
okay.
You know, and Google it, you know, this was used to great effect in some political things. No matter what the journalists asked, they'd always just give what they wanted their message to be. And so it's been abused and, you know, used and abused. But at CDC is where I learned it. You know,
you were going to say that. CDC is, I think, an important resource for that. And also what you say is testament to the importance of people like you who, I don't want to say data nerds, but you love, you know, understanding the data. And for our project, the epidemiologists, you know, we can't really succeed unless we pair epidemiologists with people who understand communications and how to reach audiences effectively, because we have to stay rooted in the true meaning of the data. And I just want to leave one thing, which is, how many people saw the film Spotlight? It just won the Academy Award, right? Oh, not as many as I thought. Okay, well, that's it's just such an interesting example of, do we, you know, what happens? The data was there, and it took a long time for the stories to surface and be heard. So it can work both ways. And I'm talking about the data around the childhood children that were abused by priests.
I just want to throw something out there that, I mean, I'm not quite as old as I look with this white hair, but I feel like putting this in, you know, whoever said if we don't know our history, we're doomed to repeat it. And we actually have made a tremendous amount of progress in population health in the last, since Playfair, last few hundred years, there's been some bits of progress. Even before the internet, even before interactive access to data. And you know, there are some data people that can write and that can speak. So it's a matter of teaming people together for sure, but it's finding maybe, as Doug was saying, kind of the important story. It's not for the story's sake, but it's because of the potential for the impact. And epidemiologists have always worked, as far as I know, with, say, health educators. And it's never been just a one-way street. There's been different labels in certain ways for some of the disciplines, but everybody knows that the paper, the way we communicate information in a scientific paper, may have to be very, very granular and detailed, and that is a story between certain people. And then it has to be boiled down for different audiences for different purposes, and I think framing it with the picture is what has to happen in some instances for sure, but I don't know whether the balance is exactly where it needs to be or not. I just don't know, but I do know that we have had tools and areas of expertise in public health, in healthcare, in medicine for making good progress, and I think we need to keep that in mind as well, that it's not all brand new, and yet it is it's very exciting. It's very exciting. We have easier, you talk about social media, easier access to reach people, but it still needs to be well grounded.
Mm-hmm. That's a fair point. Shell's pointing over there, so.
Yeah. So thank you very much, sir, for pointing out the sometimes there's a chasm between the stats and the truth. And you know, just making sure that storytelling points toward truth as opposed to points toward, and as journalists, you know what I'm talking about. I mean, in terms of what propels to action a lot of times is that disaster. And in the child welfare space where I live, you know, disaster is what is a lot of what fuels policy change. And my question is, as a public sector, one of the challenges that I think we end up having is showing the power of prevention through showing progress on crisis prevention. And so do you have any tips about that or examples of some really solid places where that's just working out like home run? And if you covered that already, and I'm sorry, I stepped out for a minute. I apologize for that.
Oh my God, that's a great question. You wanna go first?
Okay. So I'll just speak from within journalism and tell you that there's an increasing emphasis on this idea of really trying to emphasize, you know, with the same kind of rigor that journalism would traditionally use to uncover a flawed system, to try and really document something that's working well. And so that if you are doing a story on, say, obesity, and the school system in your community, you know, doesn't have a particularly good or creative policy when it comes to everything from, you know, vending machines to the physical exercise program, that reporter would be encouraged to say, go to a different community and find out what's working there and profile that as part of their series on, say, a problem or something. And I think that, you know, especially for child welfare, when I think of people in those agencies, I think that they often feel very beleaguered when it comes to the press, because often when the press visits, it's because the child has died. And so it leads to this tremendous tension that makes it hard to establish the more positive and easy-flowing relationship where you could share those things. So I guess my practical suggestion, I think it's true what my colleague here is saying, that social media is a way to tell stories without an intermediary, but if you are trying to work with journalists, to just try and develop those relationships and just try to figure out who you can trust, who's going to have what Eric's describing, that kind of rigor you know, that they're going to be using the data, that an anecdote is not a sloppy excuse for research, you know. And I think the best journalists do take all those values seriously. And, you know, so that you have someone you can tell your story to.
I think that the power of prevention is itself an incredibly powerful narrative, and that's the task of people in public health, and is to draw upon that narrative in ways that that counter the idea that, for example, child maltreatment is an intractable problem. I think that we know how to prevent and resolve a lot of abuse and neglect that goes on, and we can use stories to demonstrate that. And I would advocate for focusing on people and families that can demonstrate aspects of how that's done. But I want to actually, if you don't mind, Cheryl, can I call upon you to, Cheryl's one of the participants in our project. She's just created two stories. One's about building on the strengths of families, and the other's about looking at data related to child maltreatment. So I'm gonna let her kind of talk a little bit about those stories, and if you could just say a little bit about the goal and how you created them, what they contain, since we can't actually draw it up right now. Yeah, please. Thank you so much.
I'll try to be as brief as possible, but the challenge, we're part of this Health Data Plus team, and the challenge in LA County, and I'm contracted, I'm working with the Children's Data Network, the challenge was to reimagine a children's indicator report that we produced for years, the Children's Scorecard, reimagine it for the digital age. So we worked with this team to work on contextualizing the data, use a highly visual medium to elicit empathic responses. And so with that, we've covered several issues, but most recently we call it snapshot on preventing child maltreatment, and a second snapshot on building family and community strengths. So we really take very stark statistics about the risk of child maltreatment. 1 in 5 kids are going to be reported to child DCFS before the age of 5 in LA County. And this is based on administrative linked data analysis, very powerful data. So we wanted to really ground the data in brain science and developmental science and everything we know about toxic stress. And also we worked with a filmmaker who's in the School of Social Work at USC, Rafael Angulo, and we asked him to make a video about a massive organizing effort, community organizing effort that's going on in LA County to prevent child maltreatment. And it's using kind of grassroots organization. I don't have time to go into all of it, but it's essentially putting people in connection with each other. And when you look at this video, you don't see people that look like they're going to go hurt their kids. You know, you see families struggling with multiple stresses. And we show the data on the stresses that they're dealing with, but then how they're resolving this through this organized action. And so we've kind of illustrated the power of prevention, I guess, and some of the ways that that's happening. We published the story this past Tuesday. On Friday, we were meeting with the Office of Child Protection with the so-called Child Welfare Czar in LA County and talking about their prevention plan. So it was in a horrible nutshell, that was basically
That's
what
great.
It
Thank
about.
You, Cheryl. So we are out of time. I think I'll leave with just this one last message, because it came up, I think, repeatedly, that we all are going to need to be involved in this process of better telling stories with data. It's going to take data scientists and epidemiologists. It's going to take writers and other, you know, journalists. It's going to take designers, illustrators, cartoonists, videographers. And absolutely, it's going to take the folks on the ground who understand the issues, the researchers as well, who can really help us explain all this. So I think we should try and do all that. So great. Thank you so much.